of the day. So I wrote an application to do a year-long fellowship at the Radcliffe Institute at Harvard. And I did all this research on wrongful incarceration. And I was angry, I was outraged, I wasn't inspired. You know, I'm a storyteller, I'm not an ethnographer. And I was really, the clock is ticking, the Harvard people, they want to see what I've been up to, and all I have is a bunch of like index cards and post-it notes. So I went to Atlanta to visit my mother and to do a little shopping. All these, both these things helped
me. Thank you, by the way. Thank you for coming clean on that, yeah.
And when I was in the mall, I saw a young couple. The woman was splendidly dressed. The guy, he looked okay. She looked fantastic. And I heard her say, clear as a bell. She said, Roy, you know you wouldn't have waited on me for 7 years. And I didn't know him, and I didn't know her, but I was like thinking, you know, he probably wouldn't have waited on her for 7 years. And he said back, what are you talking about? This would have happened to you in the first place. And I was intrigued because you know you have a novel, not when you're writing about, you're supposed to write about people and their problems, not problems and their people. And in the mall, I knew I had my people.
And he also used letter writing, because obviously you have someone who's incarcerated, someone who's not, and they're communicating via letter. Is that something you knew right away to be a part of that? And you are a letter writer in real life, is this true?
Yeah, I write about 5 or 6 letters a week.
How many do you get back?
Hardly any.
Oh, that's all right.
I know, people do not write me back. But I keep hope alive, and I write all these letters. And so when I was writing between my couple, because, you know, they've only been married 18 months, and he's like, I'm going to write you a love letter every day from prison. And so you can see how their relationship comes together and falls apart from the way the letters go. Like, when she started signing them, like, yours truly, I knew it was over.
Yeah, there you go. You teach creative writing as well. Is there a piece of advice that you feel is the most helpful to give young writers when they're starting this path?
You know, I think this is the most helpful advice for writers, young, old, whatever, which is that you don't have to write every day. Because people always say, oh, a writer writes, and so people who don't have the free time to write every day, they think they can't be writers. But what does that mean if the only people writing our national story are people who have so much leisure time? The people who don't have time because they work, they have kids, they're doing elder care, I feel they have the most important stories. That's why they don't have time, they're busy.
Yeah.
And so I want to encourage busy people to know that they can be writers. It may take you longer to write your book than someone else, but your story is important and you can tell it.
That is fantastic advice. Correct me if I'm wrong, the day your book was published, you got some very exciting news, which is this was an Oprah's book club selection.
No, the day the book was published is when you got the news. I found out in October.
Oh, wow, so you had to keep it to yourself?
Yes, for 5 months. I couldn't tell anybody.
Really?
People would say, how's the book going? I would say, I'm hopeful.
I'm hopefully. So you find out, and by the way, that's so great that that's the one person that if they said you can't tell anybody, I could not tell anybody.
No.
And, you find out because she called you.
Yeah, she just rolled up on me. I was driving my car, and the phone rang, was a block call. Now, I'm the kind of person, I'm intrigued by block calls. I feel like that person blocked it for a reason. So I said, hello? And she said, hi, this is Oprah.